Why you gonna put the guy on the spot? You know, that's his colleague, what? You know.
That was the weirdest.
Yeah, exactly.
That was.
I'd like to call this meeting of the Public Works Procurement and Contracting Committee. Today's Wednesday, March 23rd, 2016. Roll call, please.
Calling the roll, Mr. Germana.
Here.
Mr. Miller.
Here.
Ms. Conwell.
Here.
Mr. Greenspan.
Here.
Ms. Simon.
Here.
There is a quorum.
Okay, we have the minutes from the March 16th. Well, I guess in order. Let's approve the minutes. Can we have a motion to approve the minutes from March 16th, 2016? It's been moved and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, nay. Minutes are approved. Okay, looking at the agenda, it was my intention to concentrate on the bonding ordinance, but they're all here. So once we get done with the bonding ordinance and we have time, we'll go to the other pieces of legislation. And then comments related to the agenda. If you have comments concerning any of those other pieces of legislation, we'll hear them. So with that said, do we have people signed up to speak?
Yes, Mr. Chair. The first one is Mr. Todd Schreck.
I have no comment.
No? Okay. Mr. Lou Calagrassi.
Good morning. I'm here in reference to Ordinance 02016006. I'm a county resident for the past 30 years and a taxpayer for the past 26 years. I spent 9 years as a surety underwriter and the past 11 years as a broker specializing in insurance and bonding for contractors of all sizes. I'm a member of the National Association of Surety Bond Producers and the Surety Association of Ohio, and have helped many SBEs achieve their business objectives relative to bonding and business growth. Due to my profession, I thought it was prudent to provide just a couple statistics. The North American bonding industry represents a $5 billion a year industry. Those are premiums generated both in the private and public sector guaranteeing projects. The state of Ohio contributes about $100 million on average in bond premiums. Again, that's both public and private sector. The county considering waiving the bonds for the small business enterprises. I don't know what the thought process is as to how much of a budgetary item, but as an example, if you threw out $4 million of work to the set-aside programs, it only represents $100,000 to our industry. We're not interested in self-serving and trying to make money off of these bonds. We're interested in protecting taxpayer dollars. We're interested in protecting the downstream parties, subs, and suppliers that are protected by these bonds. Just briefly, there's two main bonds here that you're talking about in the ordinance. The performance bond is guaranteeing that the contractor you hire will complete the contract according to the specifications issued and the contract issued. And then the payment bond protects those subcontractors, material suppliers downstream to make sure they're paid for their services that are rendered. Not impacted by this ordinance, but there are the union wage and welfare bonds, which guarantee that the contractors using union labor are providing the appropriate wages and making contributions to the pension. The $250,000 threshold contemplated, in my opinion, is a little high. Keep in mind, if you do have a default under that contract, your expenses are going to be far above potentially the bond threshold. The Federal Miller Act is $100,000, so I think maybe a threshold of $150,000 would be more in line with where we are as an economy and as a government. If the county wants to take on the risk of providing the performance guarantee and acting as a bonding company, that's fine. But the payment protection should not be waived for the small businesses that are typically the SBEs providing these services. Getting bonds today is as easy as a 1 to 2 page application with a good credit score of paying bills. The SBA is providing guarantees to the government to guarantee bonds to high risk and small businesses as well. And as I see, I'm running out of time here. The pre-qualification process, I'd be more than willing to help get together and share some experience and knowledge there. For the record, on February 17th, I sat here and spoke. That testimony was not included in the recording of the county recording, as well as another individual. I'm hoping I'm not wasting my time here today. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, sir. And this goes for all speakers. You know, once we get into this, if there's going to be comments that you want to make on what is said, you know, this is, I want this to kind of be a work session. Everybody's here, and so if you have points that you haven't made and they're pertinent to what is further discussed, I'd like to hear from you. Next.
Brian Mozina.
Good morning. Hi, good morning. Thanks for the opportunity to come in and speak. And I'm Brian Mozina. I'm a surety underwriter, so I work here in Independence for a large insurance company, and here just to share my perspective from my years of experience and let the council make the most informed decision possible with the bonding ordinance. And hopefully we can be of help in the goal of helping small contractors. My ask is that the county continue to or start to use the surety industry as a resource, however you choose to move forward with the legislation, whether it's a bond threshold or not. We have a lot of great experience on risk mitigation in this realm, so it would be a great resource. Lou touched on a lot of the importance to performance and payment bonds, so I won't hit on that necessarily, but my position is that the best public policy would be to require performance bonds and payment bonds for all construction projects for the county for several reasons. But what I'd like to hit on is really the importance of bonding as an empowerment tool for small contractors, emerging contractors, and minority contractors. I think that by waiving bonds at $250,000 threshold or less might put those companies at a disadvantage as they look to grow to the next step. For example, you know, they do a $250,000 job, the next job they're going to look at is $300,000 or maybe $400,000 job, and the underwriting requirements at that level are even higher. So essentially, by delaying the surety process, they're not able to gear their companies up for bonding and take all the necessary steps to become bondable. And they don't have that track record with a surety, things of that nature. And lastly, you know, I think if you ask any surety underwriter, the most favorite thing about their job, it's helping contractors and business owners become more successful. And sureties have a very unique perspective to share. We work with a very diverse set of clients, large companies, small companies, minority-owned, majority-owned, successful firms. And unfortunately, we work with firms that fail and go out of business. And because of that perspective, we're able to be a business advisor to our current clients, our prospective clients. We're always looking to pick up new clients and help contractors become bondable. We have our interests are very much in line with contractors in that regard. We want them to grow and be successful and viable businesses. So, again, I think that by waiving bonds, you're delaying that process, and they're missing out on a good business partner that can help them grow. So, in closing, if bonds are waived, obviously there's going to be important protections that need to be put in place, namely the payment protection. You know, you'd be taking on the performance aspect. Any warranties that would be covered by bonds obviously wouldn't be there. But I think also, as from an educational piece and helping small companies grow, there needs to be some sort of initiative put in place to actually help these companies take the next logical step to the next level without undue risk to them. So, thank you.
Okay, thank you. I've had conversations with Brian, and just so everybody knows, he recently was the president of the, I think it's called the Ohio Surety Association, right, made up of companies, and his term expired in December. So thanks for coming. Next.
Next is Russell O'Rourke.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen.
Good morning.
I'm Russell O'Rourke. I'm a resident of Cuyahoga County. I'm a past president of the American Subcontractors Association. And I'm here today to talk about the entire process. The The idea of permitting contractors who don't otherwise qualify for the construction bonds, the payment bond, which protects the taxpayer, which protects the subcontractor and supplier, the performance bond, which protects the taxpayer, and the labor bond, which protects the worker. Now, we're not really talking about a labor bond here, but the idea of having to have a labor bond to be a part of a union is an important one. And it's much easier for a contractor to have a labor bond, to be able to get a labor bond, if that same surety is also giving them a payment and performance bond. To take it a next step forward, there is a good solution rather than just cutting out payment performance bonds. If a payment and performance bond is still in place at all levels, we have the opportunity to help guide these contractors forward, but we also have the opportunity to protect all of the other parties by having the county, in essence, be a co-signer on the bond. So we know that the surety is willing to step up and provide the payment, the performance, and the labor bond. And the surety is not going to be harmed because they have played along. They have joined everybody in the whole process. There's actually a framework for something like this in the Ohio Administrative Code under the EDGE program, which is Ohio Administrative Code 122:15-1-02, which is designed to have the public authority back or co-sign for the contractors wishing to have their payment and performance bonds. This could be extended also to cover labor bonds because that is going to be the more difficult of the bonds to get. From my perspective, helping my clients who are construction subcontractors and suppliers, when I know that they are bidding to the county, I give them a recommendation, which is condition your bid on there being a payment bond available, because your risk is different. If you are bidding to contractor A, who is a qualified contractor and has a payment bond, your risk of not being paid is very low. If, on the other hand, you're working for a contractor who has no payment bond and there are no protections in place, by the way, there are alternate protections in place under the Miller Act, which is just alternative types of security. I recommend that they qualify their bid, so in the event that they are faced with a contract with a contractor having no payment and performance bond, they are not bound to take that contract. And unfortunately, that puts now the bidding contractor in a difficult situation because they may have used his number and not paid attention to the qualification, which under Ohio Supreme Court cases, people have the right to say, I've qualified my bid.
Well, thank you.
And gentlemen, thank you.
Do you have any other major points that you weren't able to cover?
Those are really them.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks, Mr. Germano.
And I'm glad to hear that you're representing the subcontractors, because that's, quite frankly, I haven't heard from that group, so I appreciate you being here. Janine? And let the record reflect that we have Councilman Purnell Jones in attendance.
Next is David Wondolowski.
Morning, council members. Stand here today representing the Cleveland Building Construction Trades Council, and we're in full support of these legislative issues here. Just want to talk to you a little bit about an enhancement for all of them in discussion today, and that is the addition of an advisory committee. Talked to several of you about that individually. We feel that modeling the legislation in a way after the City of Cleveland's Fannie M. Lewis ordinance would provide additional functionality to the legislation. And Back over 15 years ago, we put that piece of legislation together with the late Councilwoman Lewis, and it's a great piece of legislation that provides opportunities for Cleveland residents to be employed in Cleveland, assures them employment here in Cleveland, and it works. The composition of that advisory committee that we proposed would be appointments by the county executive, appointments by the there would be one individual from the building trades, one individual from the Construction Employers Association, and the president of the county council at the time. So and we would hold quarterly meetings to discuss the legislation and make any advice to the county executive and county council for modifications or improvements to the law. We'd also ask for a five-year review process, so actual formal process every 5 years to look at the legislation to see if any modifications or improvements need to be made. We believe that this these two pieces, as additions to these four pieces of legislation, would provide for the transparency and functionality that this law needs. This is not something that can be passed now and you know, in some other nature or form, take on a life of its own. We need to have some structure here, and this would provide for that structure. I thank you for your consideration.
Thank you.
Next is Mr. Glenn Shoemate.
Good morning, and I'd like to thank the community for the opportunity to speak with you today. We also really applaud your efforts to create additional opportunities for small, minority, and female businesses, and specifically our construction industry, in which CEA, Construction Employers Association, really works to enhance, I think, the development of contractors to help to build their capacity, as well as to help provide perspective for owners, public and private. And I think it's with that vantage point of having feedback from 500 contractors we represent here in Northeastern Ohio, female, minority, and large and small, you know, that I think we're really here to, again, try to offer some support from a perspective of encouraging, really, as I think Dave pointed out, maybe a process which allows there to be both a review of legislation. A lot of times we don't get things right the first time. It may take a little time to work through kinks or process. And so if we have a process that allows for review, that would be helpful, I think, to the overall efforts. It also would help from a reporting, be it transparency or just clarification publicly, and to have those parties who are involved in construction within the industry also be able to offer insights and process. And I think that effort that we've had with the City of Cleveland and that Fannie Lewis law that is currently under a 10-year review was under a 5-year review 5 years ago, and there were some modifications and changes. There's ability for the industry to communicate its impact, its effectiveness, and what's needed, what's working and what's not, and ultimately to again, improve the opportunity for public-private sector relationships. I think our, again, other experiences demonstrates that if we look around the state of Ohio, most recently the residency law, which is facing hurdles, if you will, and I think there's some consideration and concern about, you know, what requirements are. One of the factors with bonding is the federal government waiver of no bond is $150,000. Which seems, in our perspective, to be reasonable. There's data and information which you can share that there are not many states, let alone municipalities, that have a $250,000 threshold. And so for the great state of Cuyahoga to position itself as more secure than the federal government or more secure than many states may not be the pragmatic way to at least start. Certainly there are opportunities to grow to that level. I think that it is important that we do offer programs that help small contractors, things such as access to capital, which are probably as critical as bonding, would be one of those areas. prop pay, retainage, and other reforms. So again, would like to thank you for your opportunity to have discussion today, and hope that we can continue to be a resource for you.
Hey, Glenn, can you just tell me what your, I know you're with the Contractors Employers Association. What is your title?
Vice President of Education. So I work education and public affairs. So I handle both the education and training, capacity building for contractors, as well as diversity, inclusion, and educational programs within the community. Number of programs we're involved with you know, Hispanic Chamber, the Urban League, working with a lot of the high school students. We currently have 100 professionals working within 9 high schools to help mentor, provide access and opportunity, internships, and other efforts which we're actively involved with as well as at the state level.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
And next is Mr. Chris Nance.
Good morning. Thank you, Chairman Drummond, and I do have a printed copy of these same remarks, and members of the Public Works, Procurement, and Contracting Committee for the opportunity to stand in support of the ordinance of O-2016-0006, which would establish risk management procedures and performance bond insurance requirements for small businesses wishing to do work with Cuyahoga County. My name is Christopher Nance. I'm the director of the Construction Diversity and Inclusion Initiative, located at the Greater Cleveland Partnership, a unique collaborative effort. I want to first applaud council and our thanks also to the administration for endorsing the Memorandum of Understanding on yesterday evening. And as you know, that MOU, in combination with community benefit agreements, emphasizes inclusion strategies for our major construction projects. We are delighted that that MOU focuses on wealth building and increasing participation of our MBEs and FBEs on major construction projects. More specifically to the bond issue, the ordinance to waive performance bond and payment requirements for pre-qualified businesses for certain size projects is yet another important step that council is taking to eliminate regulations that have been barrier to businesses, particularly minority firms, fully participating in contracting opportunities. This is a priority outlined in GCP's public policy priorities for our inclusion efforts, and we stand with our core partners, which includes both CEA and the Cleveland Building and Construction Trades Council, who's just presented here today, many of whom support these same efforts. This ordinance will fine-tune and implement it in such a way that positions small and minority businesses to grow and to thrive. Helping MBE and FBE firms build capacity is, of course, the core focus of our work. We're in a growing demand environment as it relates to our construction efforts. However, creating access and building capacity must go hand in hand. Our next challenge is to proactively identify the business development and capacity building strategies that allow local business owners to fully leverage these opportunities. And we hope that both the administration and council are able to build on that implementation and inclusion efforts being considered. We can work together toward that goal. Thank you again for the opportunity to provide public comment for our support of this ordinance and the full package of legislation that the council is considering positioning local businesses, FBEs and MBEs in particular, to successfully compete and contribute in strengthening of Cuyahoga County. We are pleased to be partners with you in this important work. Thank you.
No one else is signed in, Mr. Chair.
Okay. So if you can, if you could read, let's see, where's my agenda here? Let's get right to 2000-0006.
Ordinance number 2016-0006, enacting chapters 507 and 508 of the Cuyahoga County Code to establish the county's risk management procedures and performance bond and insurance requirements.
Okay, as I said, and Pernell, you weren't here when I started this, we want to concentrate on the bonds, but we have the other legislation on the agenda, and once, if we could conclude the bonds and go further, then we'll introduce some other parts of it, because a lot of these things are related. So
good morning, Darlene White from the law department.
Good morning.
Would you like a background in terms of this legislation?
Sure.
Okay. This legislation basically does two things. It, one, provides the law department and risk management division with the authority to do what it's been doing, and that set insurance requirements for all the contracts for the county. The second thing it does is allow us to provide waivers for performance and payment bonds for small businesses in an effort to help the small businesses, consistent with the recommendations of the recent disparity study. One of the things that we would do in this process is to have a pre-qualification process for the contractors who come requesting waivers. It's not an automatic granting. As soon as they come and ask for a waiver, it's not automatic. They will have to go through this process to see whether or not it's a project that they can be able to perform on, that they would be able to complete the project, and they would also have to make some type of commitment in order to become bondable at some point in the future. One of the things that we'd like to do in offering a waiver is to say you have to be committed to becoming bondable by taking advantage of the resources that are out here in the community. I applaud the surety industry for coming forward today and mentioning all of the various efforts that they're willing to do to come forward and partner with the county to provide education, training, and mentorship for these small businesses that will be a great benefit for the efforts that we'd like to put forth, because one of the, as I said, they would have to make a commitment to utilize these resources so that they can increase their bonding capacity. I know that there has been some expressed concerns over the level of the bond waiver. The Federal Miller Act has been increased over the last couple of years from $100,000 to $150,000. So we would actually be consistent with the federal standards with the Miller Act in that regard for all projects that include federal funding. And the $250,000 limit, I know that there has been some expressed concern with respect to that level as well. There are some municipalities that have that level of waiver, and we understand that if we were to utilize the waiver.
Excuse me, are these municipalities in Cuyahoga County?
No, sir. No.
Okay.
I understand that if we did waivers only on $150,000 and below, during a prior council meeting, we gave the statistics that indicated that projects over the past couple of years, there was only like five projects that fell under $250,000. So if we decrease the amount to $150,000, we're looking at even less projects that we would be able to impact. And what we would like to do from this legislation is not just have it passed and have it sit on the shelf, and no one really has an opportunity to benefit from this because there aren't that many projects under $150,000. So therefore, if you take it up to $250,000, that at least provides a reasonable scope to increase the opportunity for some more SBAs.
Okay, is that, you're concluding with that?
It looked like you were, you wanted.
No, I got a number of questions, okay. But I want you to.
Okay.
Because you know, I think we're all interested in knowing where the 250 came from.
Okay.
And so you've kind of explained at least, you know, what, where the logic, because there wasn't that many jobs that this would affect. Okay. So I understand that. But if you've got anything else to add, because then I'm going to ask you some questions.
Sure. I'd also like to comment on a couple of the things that were mentioned through public comment today. I mentioned the 250 being too high, the Federal Miller Act. One of the In terms of the pre-qualification process, we would not attempt to stand in the shoes of a surety, but we would be making a very deliberate effort to make sure that the small businesses are capable of performing and completing the project and have sustainability. So that we will take that process very seriously as we're going through that pre-qualification process. So I don't want anyone to look at that as something that we will not take seriously and put a lot of effort into. Another thing that I'd like to emphasize is that with respect to us being able to put some type of protection in place for the payment in substitution for the payment bond, we currently have what's called retainage on the construction projects. Currently, I think we're at 8% with the projects. And while that certainly does not provide an apples-to-apples comparison with a performance bond and the level that they would need, it does provide some type of cushion. So where we have that 8% retainage on projects, that is an incentive for these small businesses to complete the jobs that they've started, okay? Because there is some money being retained by the county and that they want that money. In the event that the contractor just decides they are just going to walk away and that retainage is held by the county and we are unable to work with that vendor to get them to complete the job, the laborers and the suppliers, they have a lien interest in that retainage. So that is a cushion. It certainly does not, again, rise to the same level of 100% performance bond, but that is something that we can rely on. And as I've looked at Public Works and spoken with different individuals, we've never had to keep the retainage. We've always been able to work with the SBAs to make sure that the projects are complete. So we've never had to hold the retainage, nor have we had claims on performance bonds. So that's something that we take a look at as we look in terms of risk management measures and whether this is something that we should do.
The you said they would have recourse. Now, I understand that there's a situation where this is a public project and you can't put mechanical liens on public project. Is that correct?
Or? That's correct. It would not be a lien on the public project. It will be a lien on the funds that are being held in escrow for the completion of this particular project, which is not the county's funds. It's actually money that has been earned by the contractor, but is being retained until satisfactory completion of the project. And because the suppliers and the laborers have worked on these jobs, they have a lien interest with respect to that.
I'm just wondering how much the if we're talking construction jobs, you know, how much of the job is the labor part. Do you have any guesstimate as to, you know, so much goes for the product or the materials? Do you have any clue as to how much that would be?
No, sir, I do not.
One reason I'm bringing that up is I don't think 8%. On a construction job is really protection for payment of wages, okay? The other question that I have, this is just not waiving for construction. This can be also for any other supply contract. Is this piece of legislation aimed at all people that are bidding on supply or services to the county?
Yes, it would allow us the official authority to do that, is waive those bonds as well.
Okay. So my next question is, who's going to pre-qualify? How do we know that whoever is going to be making this decision on qualifying these people to be pre-qualified without bond, who's going to do that? Who's got the expertise? Are they coming from, say, a bond underwriting company? Or just who is going to be that qualified person that has got the experience to make someone and deem them pre-qualified?
It will be joint efforts of the risk management division along with our risk consultants, the Highland Group and Pickney Perry. We work collaboratively in terms of risk management measures right now.
Okay. And so you're being, see, Highland, and what's the difference? What's the roles of both of those entities?
We are currently contracted with them both. Pickney Perry is the minority vendor under that contract.
Okay, and Highland?
We're contracted with Highland Group, and Pickney Perry is the minority vendor under that particular contract. So we're contracted with both of them.
Okay, so then basically you're going to the insurance industry to make the pre-qualifications for these clients.
Correct.
Okay. So I guess the next question then is, I'm just wondering if the consultant contract, if that is going to cost the county more than what having a bonding companies pre-qualify people, where we're not paying for that pre-qualification. Can you speak to what we're budgeting to have this pre-qualification?
The current contract has a line item for risk management measures. We have not factored this particular project in at all because we have not actually gone through the process and developed it in hopes of this legislation being passed, but we haven't gone that far to develop how it will actually look and how the services would actually fall under that contract. But there is a line item for risk management measures in favor of the county.
Oh, I get it. I'm just trying to see, you know, this is kind of like maybe a hidden cost that we should at least be considering, because if we're paying contractors, subcontractors, advisors to pre-qualify, where if the insurance industry would be doing that at their expense, we wouldn't be paying for that. So the next thing that I brought up last week is, where's the reserves coming from? Where are we budgeting for the potential of one of these contractors not performing? Have we budgeted for that?
No, we have not specifically budgeted for that, this particular project, but we do have the general fund where the county is self-insured, and we take a close look at that, the self-insured portion of the general fund, as I do through the settlement process of litigation and things of that nature. I have to take a look and make sure that there's enough in the reserves to accommodate any type of settlements that we have coming down the line. And that's what we could do with this particular project until we're able to have some type of reserve put in place, and that's monitor the amount in our self-insured fund to make sure that we have enough to cover any type of loss that might come about.
Okay, so just getting into the self-insurance part, okay. Any program of self-insurance is based on a history of what the claims have been and what the potential is. So it's not free. I mean, it isn't out of air.
Correct.
Self-insurance is it's a science, an art of putting aside funds instead of buying insurance to self-pay. Okay. So if we're talking about self-insurance, I think it would be prudent for us to have some place that we're going to spell out where this is going to come from. I mean, it's got to be budgeted for. Now, the good thing about this is once we budget for this, if there's no claims, then we could keep that reserve for future and maybe even increasing, this program. So I still think with the administration, and we have our current finance chair and our prior finance chair, I'm sure they're concerned about budgeting some type of reserve. And hopefully we never have to pay for it, but I think we need to identify it. Mr. Greenspan, you care to comment about that reserve? Do you understand what I'm saying? That
I know I understand. I have a number of questions as well, and I'll defer those if you want to. Okay. Yes, I do have questions and comments on that.
Okay. The other thing that I was a little bit concerned about is the amount. And what this committee is saying, because of the size of the contracts that come to us, we have the 30% that we put on contracts for them to go to small contractors. And we've had great success for that because many times when we've had contracts coming to this committee, we look and some of the same small business enterprises are the subs to make up that 30%. And there's no dollar limit, okay? We go 30% of the project, but there's no dollar limit. So I think that, what we should be concentrating on is helping these contractors that do make it through this pre-qualification project can participate in some of these larger, much larger projects where we have a requirement for SBE participation. So I'll open up questions to Darlene White from the committee. Mr. Greenspan.
Okay, thank you. So this legislation is merely a recommendation to policy, correct? And that's where the $250,000 came from, the recommendation that would offer this program to more vendors than would be available under the federal guidelines of $150,000. Is that correct?
Partially, yes, sir.
Okay. The statement regarding the risk management statement that we've had no claims, at least going back to 2011, on a performance bond, no demands, is that also partially or largely due to the fact that those who apply into the county are bondable, and so they have a history of providing successful service?
That could be.
And the folks that would fall under this program, and I don't have an issue with providing an opportunity, would be those who have not had the same success in delivering contracts, thus why they have a challenge in obtaining bonds?
That could be the case, sir.
Okay. I just wanted to make sure I understood exactly the position and where we were coming from. Mm-hmm. Question on the retainage. So it was last week there was a discussion of where the set-aside may be applicable, and one example was that of a $1.6 million road project as an example, $800,000 may be set aside for an SBE program. Would it be possible that SBE, that full $800,000 program, a number of vendors could qualify under at $250,000 for a waiver of a bond? Could
you mean if it was split up?
Yeah, could four
to
vendors
fall under 250?
Yes.
If
8% retainage on $800,000 would only be $64,000 worth of funds available from a retainage perspective, if even just one vendor failed to perform, then there would not be enough retainage to cover the exposure. Is that correct?
That's true. I understand 8% is not a 100% performance or payments bond.
Okay. And that goes to the discussion Mr. Germana discussed, and I think we discussed it in the past, that that the county would need to set up a dedicated reserve for exposure until such time as Mr. Germanis said, whether it's an art and or science, whether actuaries get involved, as typically happen when you self-insure, to determine what an appropriate level of reserve would be. You made a statement that's curious that we're self-insured, or the expectation would be self-insured and supported by the general fund. Are you saying that the expectation is the general fund reserves in total, the 25%+ would be the reserve that would be used for backup to this program?
No, I was referring to the fact that our self-insured fund comes under the general fund.
And what self-insured fund are you speaking of?
Well, it's a self-insurance fund that we utilize in terms of litigation and claims that are filed against the county.
And what's the balance of that fund?
I don't have that balance currently, sir.
Okay. I need, if Mr. King could identify that for me, that'd be helpful. Because my understanding is that all falls under the general fund, unless there's a sub-fund within the legal department that I'm unaware of.
No, it's not specifically within the legal department.
Okay, then it's got to be, okay. To my knowledge, we don't have a self-insurance fund for litigation claims. It comes out of the general fund reserves. But I'd like to have more detailed information on that. I don't know, Mr. Boatwright, do you know anything about that?
I don't, but I will find out right now.
Okay, thank you. Yep. The you made the statement that $250,000 is used elsewhere, and Mr. Germana asked if there were any municipalities within Cuyahoga County. You said no. Can you provide us a list of where, or give us some examples of some political subdivisions where $250,000 is the number?
I have not found any here in Ohio, but I know that there are some that exist. I can get those.
Yeah, if you can get those, that would be great, because the research that the little research I've done and information provided, there's no one in the country above 150,000. But once again, I could be mistaken and maybe didn't look hard enough. There was a definition of defining the pre-qualification criteria, and I believe that's still being developed. Is that correct?
Well, the pre-qualification criteria, we actually know that criteria. We just don't know the entire process that will go into it as it relates to the collaborative efforts.
Okay. There's one specific, I mean, I'm troubled by the 250, unless proven otherwise. One of the main problems that I have with this is in 508.02a, where it basically says that the performance bond, payment bond, may be waived for contractors who pre-qualify. And where that, I believe, provides an unfair playing field is if you have a pre-qualified vendor who's not required to include in their bid a performance bond or the financial component of a performance bond, 3%. And a vendor who's able to obtain a bond is bidding it at the same time. They're not the bond who is bondable is going to have their quote be higher, thus eliminate their availability to participate in the process. Whereas if the performance bond waiver is offered, then obviously if you're looking on a cost basis, it's going to be an uneven playing field. And I understand the purpose of legislation is to provide an opportunity. And I have no issues with providing the discussion about providing an equal opportunity. Mm-hmm. But clearly, we're not in the business of providing outcomes. And my concern is with that language, we are providing an uneven playing field for contractors. And so I'd like the discussion around removing that provision from this legislation. And there are other programs that we can look to, including the state's program, that require a pre-qualified vendor to even pay 2% for a bond supported by a reserve established by the county. That way there's a backstop there. It levels the playing field a little more, but it doesn't leave it as it's currently stated, where basically somebody who is bondable is disadvantaged in being able to participate because they have a higher credit score, have a history of successfully completing projects or whatever the criteria may be.
I'm sorry, did you say there is an existing program?
The state program.
Is that the Ohio Minority Business Program?
Mm-hmm. Right. So I've got information if you'd like. You're familiar with it.
I'm familiar with it. Yeah, it so also requires that they have a 20% a line of credit,
sure,
equal or greater than 20%. Right. In most cases, if these contractors have that line of credit, they are bondable, mm-hmm, and wouldn't have to seek a waiver. So but that is an obstacle that they continue to have with that particular program.
But there are businesses that do participate in that program, correct?
Yes, there are. Mm-hmm.
So they must be unbondable, even though they've got a 20%, meet that 20% threshold to participate in the state program, correct?
No, they don't have to be unbondable to participate in that particular program.
They just choose not to seek a bond through traditional means. They rely on the state program to provide them that bond availability.
They may feel that they have a better advantage going through that particular program.
Well, I'm just saying there are other ways for us to take a look at this. At the end of the day, we've got an obligation to protect the taxpayers of Cuyahoga County and at the same time balance the opportunity that's being offered by this legislation. So we're trying to find the balance here and how to make it work. Mm-hmm. You know, we're not saying no, this is unworkable, but we've got to be able to find that balance. I'm not sure this legislation as presented defines that balance. So I'll look forward to receiving the information that either Mr. Boatwright, Mr. King, or you'll provide to my questions.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, Mr. Miller.
Mr. Chairman, Ms. White, for a $250,000 project, what would a performance bond typically cost a contractor?
Anywhere from 1% to 3%.
Okay. And is the problem that we're dealing with that the contractors can't afford the bond or that they can't get the bond?
In most cases, they can't get the bond, but there could be an issue where they can't afford it.
Understood. Okay, and you said that at the $150,000 level, perhaps only five contracts on an annual basis would fall into play. How much would that increase to if we used the $250,000 number?
I'm not sure. I know that with the current efforts, intended efforts of the various legislation, we're trying to be able to break up the projects. Hmm. I think the intent is to break up the projects so that they can be smaller and small businesses can have more opportunities. So hopefully it will allow an increased number of those contracts.
Could you work on trying to get an estimate of what might be a goal of how many projects you would be able to handle on an annual basis with the 250 number?
Sure.
Okay. And is this program going to be used only for prime contractors, or could it also be used for subcontractors that are bidding on components of larger projects that are less than 250?
Currently, we have the intent of it being just with primes. You're not going to really get large primes coming and asking for waivers. So we were thinking that perhaps these small projects would be for small business primes who would come and seek those. But I think there is the opportunity for there to be subs who come on with contracts with that amount. For subs as well.
Okay. We heard testimony earlier today that subs are being instructed that they should make their bid perform contingent on there being a payment bond. And my question is because of that, do you anticipate that contractors who get waivers might have difficulty getting the subcontractors they need to do their projects? And if not, how would we how would we get around the fact that subs are making payment bonds a contingency in their bids?
I'm sorry, I didn't understand your question.
Let me try it again.
Okay.
We heard testimony from one of the people at the beginning of the session today that it's being recommended to contractors that are bidding to be subs that their bids are including a statement saying that their bid is contingent on there being a payment bond in the contract. And so if we grant a prime a waiver so that they don't have to provide a payment bond, my question is might they have difficulty getting the subs that they need because the subs are saying that their bids are contingent on there being a payment bond, and if there's not a payment bond, well, then their bids would not be effective. So how do we get around that?
I think that in this particular circumstance, we're looking at $250,000, and if you're going to have subs on a project like that, they're going to be smaller businesses, some minority and female-owned businesses, who are just going to be appreciative of the fact that they can come to the table and have the opportunity to bid on these types of projects. And that's probably something that can be worked out as long as they know ahead of time that there won't be a payment bond in place.
And if we were to grant a waiver and a contractor not perform, and some subs not get paid, would the county be on the hook for paying the subs, or would that be between the prime and the subs?
It would be between the prime and the subs. It's nothing not to say that they wouldn't try to come after the county, but it would be between the prime and the subs.
So we could be subject to litigation?
Potentially.
And could there be scenarios where we could be subject to litigation for liabilities beyond non-performance amounts, such as punitive damages or anything like that?
For non-performance?
Yes.
Not to my understanding, sir.
So you're suggesting the limits of our liability would probably be the extent of the non-performance.
Project. Correct.
Okay. And you're saying that under the current system, we have not had non-performance problems, but this might be due to the fact of that we've had bonding requirements.
My understanding from discussions with Public Works is there have been a couple of occasions where the contractors, there was a delay in performance. They've been able to work with those contractors. And again, because they're dangling, you know, part of their funds and they're holding them back in terms of retainage, those contractors are more apt to go ahead and complete the project and perform because they want that money that's due to them. So, but there has not been an incident where we have not had non-performance on a project, just delays.
Okay, Ms. Simon.
My question was, what's the difference between the projected job projects between 150 and 250? And your answer is you don't know, that perhaps you've only looked at how many jobs with the 150 limit, and you said it would be around 5. And there was just an extension to increase this without any kind of data. And I guess that I would need to have that as well, because this is a risk for the county. And if we're going to do this, it has to be more than just saying we want to be more comprehensive. I think we need to give this what we would consider strict scrutiny from the legal side of things, and I'm troubled by that. And if we're going to take a risk, I'm inclined to just stick with the 150 until we know how that works, rather than just opening this up as something, as an aberrant number, inconsistent with any other municipality or political subdivision. So that's just my initial commentary on that. But if you can give us some data, I would appreciate that as well. In terms of balance, this is a balancing act. Definitely, we want to be more inclusive and be able to implement the recommendation of that disparity study. But I'm concerned about concentrating everything in risk management, because that's really what we're doing here, is to exclude community, exclude council to some extent, and just look at things on the front end with risk management, concentrated with a few people at the executive. So what's wrong with considering the Fannie Lewis community type of situation, where we have a board that can come together regularly, especially within the first 2 years? I've been saying this is something we need to monitor. So what would be wrong with having inclusion and transparency that way?
That just has not been considered as a part of this legislation. I don't know that anything would be wrong with that type of model, but I have not had any consideration of that for this legislation.
So what this does is it puts the subcontractors at risk, because if they have to make a claim against the retainage, they're never going to be satisfied 100%, because they just won't. And I agree that perhaps they won't be bidding on these jobs, and that's their own personal risk to know that they'll be working and might encounter a project where they won't get paid, at least without a lot of expense from attorneys to put liens against this retainage trust fund. So that's my concern from the beginning, is we're not even going to get the people or companies bidding on jobs because of this waiver requirement. And that's why I would like to see more scrutiny throughout the process and consider having this type of board, or to be able to monitor this every, you know, more frequently than this council. And we need to have a seat at the table, I think, as well. So those are my comments. But those are my concerns. I don't see why we need to go from 150 to 250 without any kind of data.
Councilwoman Simon, where are you getting the 150 from? And what were?
With the bond requirements. Federal funded projects, it's okay. 150, and that's the consistent waiver amount. But then we jumped it, they increased it to 250 without any kind of analysis or data to support that leap. Or else maybe it's there, and
I'm
don't know yet. That's okay.
I was asking her if she had that breakdown.
The differential
there
of the projected amount of jobs or projects.
Lenore Lockett, Office of Procurement and Diversity. Since 2008, which goes back, and that's an odd number, but that's when I became director. So since 2008, there have been 18 projects that have had that were under 250,000. Of those 18 projects, one was a road project. It was a short road, small road project. Four were bridges, and they were mainly not complete bridge rehabs. They were deck replacement, deck ceilings, things of that sort. And then the remaining 14 projects were building, like roof replacements on the Metzenbaum or Board of Development. Four of the projects were developmental disabilities for their facilities, rehabilitation projects for their facilities. And some the other projects were building projects, but they were scope focused, meaning one was the emergency vehicle signal at the Fitch Road project. Another project that was under 250, two of them were Department of Development, where they did a bidding process for their funds for rehabs for HVAC and weatherization at different community or HUD eligible facilities. So just in general, there aren't, on average, if you look at 18 over, 8 years, you're about two projects a year. Under 150, there probably were So out of the 18, six were under 150. So the remaining 12 would have been over 150. So as she stated, going that extra 100,000 provided two times the amount in that period.
So, you know, what I could say concerning that is back then we weren't even thinking about it. Public Works was thinking about, hey, how big is this job going to be? We're going to estimate it and we're going to go out to bid. But the thinking, and Mr. I'm looking at Mr. Dever, I was checking to see if you were in. But the thinking now is that we're not just going to go out and make things our life simple and go out and get a 500,000, 600,000 job. But if there's a way of doing pieces, we're going to do that to make use of this and get more people involved. Is that the thinking, Mr. Dever?
Yes, and I think the reference Councilman Greenspan made about a road construction project, we just recently put out a series of groupings of road projects and that covered multiple streets. I think we may look at it as breaking some of those up into smaller pieces. Some of them probably would fall under the $250,000 level based on our engineer's estimate. Also, there's small culverts that we do, small bridges, really, to that extent. We talked about some, one of the projects Lenora made reference to was a deck ceiling project that we do. It's just restoration for the bridges to get additional life out of them. So we're going to continue to look at it and refine it where it makes sense, where there's enough smaller contractors available, SBEs, to do this type of work. So we're still working through those rules, and I think we've got some information that may be available in the near future here about how that process will be determined. So, but yes, that we're going to start looking at it and how many of these projects are out there. And I was happy to hear Lenora had that data about 18 projects. And I think we can expand that a little bit wider also. Okay. Thanks.
Okay. And we're going to go to Mr. Jones. But, you know, I think I said it in previous meetings that this really is going to be reaching a limited amount of contracts because we're just talking about Cuyahoga County. But ultimately, as a county, if we could get this right, as you know, I am a big supporter of the sanitary engineer because we can do things for cities that they can't do by themselves because of specialization. And if we could develop something that's workable and be able to expand protection to all the cities so that they can use these contractors, it would be helpful. But at the same time, we've got to protect to the full amount, just as if we're going to waive bonds, this city is this county has got to stand behind payment. So yes, if we get to a point where we're going to waive, we're standing instead of a bonding company, and part of that is paying, guaranteeing payment. And if we pre-certified them, we're going to be pretty sure, because they're pre-certified by consultants, that they are not going to perform. But if there's a mistake, and they are, the workers and the suppliers of the materials should not be stuck because we were not complete. And if we're going to waive bonds, we should be standing in instead of the bonding company. Mr. Jones.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. To that point and the earlier concerns about the expertise around determining our risk management. I'd like us again to kind of put it in a certain context. Under $250,000, we're hearing a dozen to 20 contracts that we would be putting the county tax dollars at risk. The risk management team, along with Highland and Pinckney Perry, that team determines the risk. And they've done an excellent job at that. And it's not simply setting aside X amount of dollars. They have a toolbox of tools that they use to determine the risk on each project. And again, to put it into context, let's go back to our convention center hotel. We're not talking about 20 contracts of $250,000. That adds up to a few million dollars. We're talking about a convention center hotel that was a $230 to $260 million project with no performance bond. No performance bond. We put the county at risk for $260 million, quote unquote, with a convention center hotel, again, that had no performance bond. Okay, the team put together an assortment of tools to offset the risk. We did not set $260 million aside, an equal amount, but they put together a toolbox of tools. And Darlene, I'd ask you to like for you to share with us just what that was, some of those tools that were used to protect the county in the context of the hotel.
I think you're referring to the corporate guarantee.
The corporate guarantee, certainly. Yes.
Yeah. Why don't you?
And again, the corporate guarantee is Turner Construction Company, an international company, guaranteed that they would, to put it in layman's terms, guaranteed that if they failed to perform on the project, they would use their own strength as a company, their own, again, corporate guarantee that we will get this project done. And because of the size of this company, they could, quote unquote, go into this sofa cushion and pull out $260 million if they failed to do the job. So that was, in a sense, a corporate guarantee from them that they would get the job completed. Okay. So again, that is one tool amongst others on the many projects that they use. So the dollars that we're talking about making an opportunity to expand contracting opportunities in the community, our risk management team, I believe, is has the expertise and experience and the practice at doing this to actually protect the county tax dollars, the residents' tax dollars, as we make these outside-the-box thinking efforts. The $250,000 performance bond threshold, I do support that. Again, it's greater than the 150 of the federal government, but we will abide by the federal government's guidelines when their dollars are involved. I believe that was stated, and it's been done in other parts of the nation, and it's an opportunity for us to do as well, to provide again an opportunity. So I do support the $250,000 threshold.
Okay, so I understand what you're saying there, but waiving the bond on the convention hotel, I mean, we didn't waive it. We transferred the risk, and they
another
stood,
risk management measure, correct?
Right. Yeah. We stood behind the financial statement of the contractor. So,
and that obviously wouldn't be an option for these vendors or these contractors who
exactly so
can't get bonded, okay, because they certainly wouldn't be able to have, okay, a corporate guarantee.
Okay, so
here. And there are other tools. We're not talking strictly a corporate bond. There are a wealth of tools that the risk management team uses to determine on each project whether a performance bond is required or not.
Yes. Mr. Miller?
I just have one more procedural question, and it's as to whether if a contractor came in and got pre-qualified and were approved, would that pre-qualification be just for one specific project, and if they wanted to bid on another project and get a waiver, they'd have to be pre-qualified again, or would it be a case of once a contractor is pre-qualified, that then they could have their bond waived on any project under $250,000 on an ongoing basis?
Well, that hasn't been finalized. What I would envision is that if they have taken steps towards their commitment of increasing their bonding capacity, and once they've had a waiver, then they would be eligible for another bond to assist with their project portfolio in increasing their bonding capacity. But if they have not taken the steps towards their commitment to increase their bonding capacity, we probably would not. That's what I envision, although that's not finalized.
Understood. Thank you.
Mr. Greenspan.
I want to support Councilmember Simon's statement regarding the advisory committee, just so we're all at least understanding where each other may be coming from on that. Through the advancements of modern technology in my memory, there is a self-insurance fund. The budget has $600,000 a year. However, that fund did not contemplate the additional risk of assuming this type of activity. Correct?
That's correct.
So if we were to engage in this type of activity, we would need to increase, hence the increase in the reserve, in a reserve, whether it's self-insurance or a separate reserve for this, to assume some of the potential obligation or exposure that the county may have.
That's correct. That's why I was suggesting if we monitor that at this particular point, mm-hmm. and then plan in the future for some type of reserve.
Right, and I would argue that the general statement that we've had no claims prior to is an accurate statement, but may not apply to this population that may be granted a waiver, because there obviously is a reason why that they're seeking this type of program.
I'm sorry, can you say that again?
Yeah, I said it's safe to say that the same criteria for determining or using, relying on the fact that there has been no demand on a performance bond in the past, that same criteria is would not apply to the population that would be applying for this waiver program, because they're unbondable at this point. There is an increased risk as opposed to a vendor that is bondable.
There would be several reasons why a company would be unbondable. Right. It wouldn't necessarily mean a claim had been filed on a bond in the past.
No, but they're not qualifying for a bond. One of the criteria we heard last week is to be eligible for the pre-qualification program is you have to have demonstrated that you were turned down for a bond elsewhere for whatever reason, whether it was credit, whether it was an equity position, whether it was any other qualifying factor. So there is an increased risk by waiving the bond for these pre-qualified applicants.
I understand that is something that some of the sureties look at. That hasn't been considered as part of our pre-qualification criteria, them being denied a previous bond.
We were told last week it was.
By?
Ms. Lockett, Director Lockett.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry.
I remember specifically asking the All right, we'll play back the tape. I'm not going to be proven wrong on this.
Can you just restate what your
statement was? Is that one of the qualifications for qualifying for this program is you demonstrated your ability that you were turned down for a performance bond elsewhere. I'll play back the tape. I'll give the timestamp and I'll send it to the director.
Okay.
Okay. I have nothing further.
Okay. I have basically a question to, we've got some bond underwriters here. One of the questions that I have is that if you're the prime contractor on a larger project, and you're going to, that contractor was going to use one of these contractors without a bond, does the prime contractor, are they back bonded by the subcontractors? Does the underwriter of the prime contractor request that the subcontractors back bond the contractor? And that, I think that's an important thing for us to understand.
Yeah, so if the prime contractor to the county has posted a performance and payment bond to the county, a bond in its simplest form guarantees a single contract. So the contract between the county and the general contractor is guaranteeing essentially that that contractor, the general, will complete the contract and deliver it to the county. That would be the same if they have one subcontractor and supplier under them or 100. Now, whether or not a bonding company would go to a general contractor and say, you know, we're going to support you and move our capital behind this bond and guarantee it to the county, but because we're monitoring all your other work and you're stretched pretty thin with all the amount of contracts you have going on in the area, we feel it'll be prudent to get some back bonding from some critical subcontractors. It wouldn't be every one, but if it's a $10 million project, they might say, hey, any subcontractor that's got a package with you of $1 million or more, we'd like you to transfer that risk and get a sub bond from them. So in case they default or do not perform the contract, their critical path schedule isn't messed up and allowing the general contractor to deliver that project to the county.
And just, I know you're Lou.
Yeah, Lou Colagrassi.
Colagrassi, okay.
I work for Dawson Insurance. We're a broker.
Okay. Thank you. Mm-hmm. That answers that question. So, okay, so what we want to do is we want to move forward. Okay, so... one of the things that have been discussed is the this construction inclusion advisory committee. Okay, we've got some suggested language because it's worked. It's worked in the city of Cleveland, and just so we're clear, it referenced the Fannie Lewis ordinance in Cleveland. We're not talking about trying to duplicate the Fannie Lewis endorsement, only on the advisory committee, okay? And this is just to have different parts that are interested in this that would be, they're suggesting, because it's worked in Cleveland and it's working very well, that this construction inclusion advisory committee would be made up by a representative from the county executive. The president of council would put one person in, the Cleveland Building and Construction Trades, the executive director of the Construction Employers Association, and representative appointed by both the executive and the council president. So the only other, I'm just wondering if the, I really didn't know that there was a subcontractors association. And I don't know if there is how big that association is, and if there would be any interest by that organization to be one of those representatives on this review committee. So, Mr. O'Rourke, can you address that?
Thank you, Mr. Germain. Yes, I'm Russell O'Rourke, and the American Subcontractors Association is kind of twofold. It's a national organization with chapters across the country, and overall we have about 5,000 members. Ohio, I don't know the number we have, but you know, clearly we're only a small portion of that 5,000. We represent subcontractors and suppliers. We don't represent them. They join us, and we work together, particularly in advocacy issues like this one, and would be very pleased to participate in such a program.
How many members are from Cuyahoga County?
I don't know. What'd that number.
You guess? I mean, just educated guess. No.
20.
Okay.
The one that has really the greater impact is the Builders Exchange. The Builders Exchange, we have over 2,000 members, most of which are in Cuyahoga County. I happen to be the president of the Builders Exchange at this point, and I have been on their board for, of course, years. So both the Builders Exchange, which represents the broad spectrum of all facets of the construction industry, from owners
to contractors, to subcontractors, both union and non-union, and suppliers, of course. So the Builders Exchange would also be very interested in participating.
Okay.
May I answer one other question? We've been talking a lot about 8% retainage. 8% retainage, actually, it's in 153.12 of the Ohio Revised Code, and it doesn't say 8%. It says it backwards. It says what the public authority will do is pay 92%. But that 92% of the estimate is 92% of labor only, and they pay 100% on materials. And that's only for the first 50% of the job. It's exactly the way the statute's written. So really what happens is there's 8% retainage on labor only for the first 50% of the job and 0% after that. And the thumbnail I used to answer your question before of how much is labor and how much is material, of course it varies with the complexity of the project. Some have very, you know, high cost product that's going in, and some have very labor intensive.
So what's the rule of thumb?
The rule of thumb I use is 50-50.
Okay.
And what that really means is that by the time you finish the job, you've got 8% of labor over the whole project, which is equals 4% of labor, which actually is about 2% of the whole job. So the retainage that we have is really very limited.
That's the point I was trying to get to. Thank you. And that helps clarify it.
Thank you, Mr. Germano.
Okay, so what I'm suggesting is that we forward this language to Mike King that has been suggested, and put that into a potential substitute as one amendment to this legislation. Is there any objections to having Mike craft that and present that to us at the next meeting?
Councilman?
Yes.
May I ask a question?
Sure.
I understand that we heard Mr. Rourke, Dave, earlier mention this advisory committee. Can you explain, since you're going to suggest the amendment with that language, what the benefit of this type of committee would be for this particular legislation?
Well, basically, the benefit is, you know, it's their business that we're discussing, and that this would just be reviewing what the progress has been, and it pretty much is irregularly scheduled. I think they would meet quarterly, and we would find out what progress there would be. I see Mr. Wondolowski, you want to answer the question directly?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We just want to, we're asking that language be placed into all four of the bills, and that all four pieces of legislation are then reviewed, every 5 years, and we have quarterly meetings for modifications or improvements on those pieces of legislation. So it's not just this piece, it's actually all of them that we're looking to review and potentially, you know, make suggestions. We would have no, capacity to change those pieces of legislation. We would only be able to advise county executive and county council on potential changes to improve it. So there'd be no authority in the committee at all, other than to meet on a regular quarterly basis and then do a 5-year review like we do with the Fannie Lewis law.
So as long as you're up there, Can you speak to how effective this has been with the city of Cleveland and some of the things that it helped the legislation?
Sure, I can give you a couple of examples. When Fannie Lewis was started, the Fannie M. Lewis law was started 15 years ago, I believe. It was new to everybody, all parties involved. But we all stood behind it. We thought it was great. In the first 5-year review, which I participated in, we realized that there were some flaws in the law. One was the residency requirement, the actual residency, you know, definition. When was a person, because what was happening was we were putting City of Cleveland residents through apprenticeship programs, getting them to work, and they were moving out of the city, okay? And unfortunately, but that's what was happening. And so what we were talking about was how long is an individual considered a resident? You know, because we have to, we wouldn't want, if somebody decided that they thought moving their family out of the City of Cleveland was going to be a benefit, we didn't want them to be penalized and lose their job for it. So there's a five-year provision now that they're City of Cleveland resident under the Fannie Lewis law. Another example was the low-income requirement with Fannie Lewis, which is an optional piece of that law, voluntary piece, but it's a piece that our contractors use all the time because we're constantly trying to bring, you know, people low-income status into the building trades to improve their quality of life and give them a career. Well, what was happening was, and this is something we're still discussing right now, but there's another flaw in the law, another glitch in which an individual is considered low income when he's hired. But in order to continue his low income status, he could never leave that contractor for 5 years. He would have to stay with that contractor. And in the construction industry, that's just not possible. You move from contractor to contractor. Once an individual exceeded his low income level and was laid off, let's say for either lack of work or inclement weather, he would then lose his low income status. So we're now, the proposal now is to make that a 5-year provision again, so that if he's in the low, within the low income status when he's hired, he's got that for 5 years. Even if his salary or his earnings are $30,000, $40,000, $50,000 per year, he's still considered low income. So the idea behind that was to make sure that we were able to carry somebody through the term of an apprenticeship program.
So basically, you answered my question. The purpose of this is just to have eyes on our program and see if it's working okay and if there's some improvements to it.
That's all it is. So, Mr. Chairman, there's no authority at all. What it really goes back to is transparency and functionality of the legislation.
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly. So no one should feel threatened by this.
No.
Because this is something that, instead of giving the, well, by council putting this in here, we have a mechanism for other eyes that are involved in the business to look at this. So
we're here to assist, not the obstructionists. We're here to help.
I get it. Mr. Miller?
I'm supportive of the concept of the advisory committee. My question is that I would like to see there be annual reports, like especially on this legislation, to know how many contractors were pre-qualified and given waivers, and how many contractors won bids with the waiver, and whether there were any performance problems. And my question is whether putting these reports out would be a responsibility of the advisory committee, or is that something that would be done separately by the administration? I'm just wondering, any thought about that?
Well, Mr. Councilman, thank you. If you look at the model that we have through the Construction Diversity and Inclusion Committee with the Greater Cleveland Partnership in the City of Cleveland, we have an ongoing website that's completely monitored by the Diversity and Inclusion Committee. Chris Nance is here today, who is very involved with that. But one thing we did not take on today, because we feel that this advisory committee will serve that purpose, but we didn't talk about the reporting. And the reporting is really a fundamental part of this whole process. You have to have very distinct reporting and very, very consistent reporting to make sure that, you know, A, this law is actually working, and B, it's helping people, and C, who it's helping. You just can't, I don't personally believe in a piece of legislation that is passed by a body and then it gets shelved, and you know it's going to benefit some people, but we don't, you know, in 5 years we don't really know who it benefited, and there's no real litmus test to see who it helped. So I do believe that the advisory committee is at the start of that. But you know, we need to track our results. We need to see who we're helping, and maybe in 5 years we say, hey, this is working great, and we don't need to change a thing. And maybe the whole thing needs to be changed in 5 years. But
that's exactly what we're looking for. And you know, certainly we will be tracking. The council will be tracking. The other thing is, we're going to have another diversity study, because we're going to be trying on the next time around to be able to quantify the lack of women's businesses and minority. So that's coming. That's coming, because the diversity study was only for 5 years. We're, 3 years into it, Mr. Jones?
2014 to 2019 are the time frames between each study.
So we're 2019 we're right in the middle. Study. We're right in the middle. Mm-hmm. So, you know, the next study is going to try, you know, to move it. So thank you very much. Okay. So the some questions we had prepared by our staff to look at this. It had to do with, let's see here. Actually, it comes down to the Business Economic Inclusion Program. But the question, is it identified in this legislation that this is... these contractors have got to be a Cuyahoga County domiciled. This only applies, the waiver is only going to apply to Cuyahoga County domiciled establishments. Is that correct? Or
it's not a part of the legislation, but it will be a part of the pre-qualification process.
Okay, well, I think that's one other thing that we would probably want to address. If we're going to pass this, and if we're going to be on the hook with our self-insurance, I think it's got to be stated that this is a Cuyahoga County entity, because we're backing it up with real dollars. Okay, and then the other part of this that you know I'd like to see. Some language as to this waiver and the self-insurance is going to back the full payment. Okay, so if we're going to waive bonds and not have a bonding company, we're standing as the bonding company, and it could be reserves. I'm not saying that we got to have that, but we just need to identify that. Mr. King, are you straight on that? Okay, is there any other items that we would like to see possibly changed language for a subsequent substitute? Mr. Miller?
I don't have a proposed change, but I have one more question, which is as to whether contractors would apply for pre-qualification prior to bidding on a contract, or would they tentatively win a bid and then apply for waiver of the bonding requirement?
It will be before bidding on the project.
Okay, fine. Thank you.
I have a number of suggestions, but I'll meet with Mr. King and circulate them.
Okay.
Most of which I've discussed here today.
Yeah. See, the other thing that is very important, I think, because we want to have. We don't want to be unfair to the people that can get a bond, okay? And so when we have these projects, we've got to address the fact that the contractor that can get the bond is going to be handicapped because his price is going to include the cost of the performance bond. So I don't know how we get around that, but if we could have language between the law department and Mr. King to solve that, I think it should happen because we want to be fair. We don't want to be anti people that are performing well.
That's on the list.
Mr. Chairman, along that same line, I'm thinking we should consider any contractor that wins a bid with a waiver would pay somewhere between 1% and 2% to the county, and that would go into your risk pool and help provide a buffer against any performance problems.
Thank you.
Mr. Jones.
Okay. I just want to, what we've discovered was, again, a racial disparity. This wasn't a transportational disparity. We didn't study whether someone had a car or could they get to a job or we looked at the existing capacity in the industries and compared them to the opportunities available, and we found that based on race, there were those who were not getting an opportunity. Okay, I am not an expert in the surety industry. I can't speak to that industry or to the contractors who may or may not have gotten a contract. So when we talk about being unfair to those who were bondable and those who are not bondable, I have an issue with that premise. And all I can do is share my own experience and my own perspective. I'm a small business owner, and my family tried to build a funeral home throughout the 80s. After being in business for several decades, we tried many banks across the city of Cleveland to get loans, and we could not get a loan, okay? Maybe we weren't qualified or bondable, so to speak. Maybe there was some issue. We didn't know because I'm not a bank. All I could do is plug along and keep working day in and day out in the hopes of being able to get the loan to grow my business and support my family, okay? It wasn't until the city of Cleveland received the federal program dollars of the Empowerment Zone, a $100 million federal program where the government, city of Cleveland, federal government stepped in and partnered with private sector banks to give our business a loan. We received a loan. We paid $800,000 was given to us in 1995 and 1998, and we repaid it in full 10 years later in 2008. And First Merit Bank was brought to the table, a bank that actually would not give us a loan a few years earlier, okay? I've heard conversations around redlining and all those things. I don't know. I can't speak to it. All I know is that I couldn't get a loan in a neighborhood that the Empowerment Zone targeted as one where investment needed to happen. We were given a loan, and we repaid it in full within 10 years. So I look back and say, I was qualified and capable of getting a loan, but I would have fell in that unbondable, that category of businesses who were not qualified to get a loan. So from my perspective, there's an unfairness for those who we don't know if they were bondable or insured. I don't know if the surety industry can say concretely that those that don't have bonds, they certainly did not deserve them. I don't know. All I can say is from my experience, okay, the private sector banks had work to do. And I don't put a gold star on those who got a bond, and I don't put a scarlet letter on those who have not gotten a bond. Okay, but there's work that needs to be done, and we are making that effort now.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, Mr. Miller?
My question is whether a business would have to be a certified small business in order to apply for a waiver.
It'll be consistent with the current SB programs in terms of certification.
So they would need to be a small business?
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
Okay. Thanks, everyone, for attending this meeting. We will be having our next meeting next Wednesday at 10 o'clock, and we'll be looking to discuss the substitute that's going to be presented, and we will be reviewing the other pieces of legislation. I know there were a number of people that had a 12 o'clock appointment. So is there anybody signed up to speak not related to the agenda, Janine?
No, Mr. Chair, okay. No one signed up.
Well, thank you very much for attending, and this meeting stands adjourned.